Dick was kind of a serious guy. And importantly, he took being a grandparent seriously. It wasn't just the stuff he made, which I'm sure my son Riley will tell you all about. It was the countless trips he made from Connecticut for even just a one-day visit. It was the interest he took in Sarah and Riley's education. It was his willingness to listen and give good attention to both children. For that, I'm grateful. I do remember leaving him speechless two times. The first was when I called him up in the old-fashioned ritual of asking for his daughter's hand in marriage. The second time was when Ann and I together told Mary and Dick that they were going to be grandparents. He was quiet. Was he stunned? Or his hearing aid batteries low? Fortunately, in both cases, it turned out he was genuinely pleased. When I first met Dick and Mary, my own father had been dead for 20 years, and my mother almost 5. I was pleased that my then new girlfriend came from a family that exemplified hard work, honesty, and compassion, in addition to being a skiing family, which was a true requirement in my search for a life partner. Thank you, Dick. You will be missed.
Good morning. My name is Wyatt, and this is what I was going to say. I wrote in my son, Papa was a really nice person. Before he passed away, he made me and my sister a beautiful red kayak and a workbench. Ever since Papa died, I felt like something is bothering me, like something 200 years old broke, and now there is something missing. But I also think Pop-Up is still with us. In Star Wars Episode 3, Yoda says to Anakin, death is a nature part of life. Rejoice for those around you who transform into the Force.
So I'm going to say something on behalf of Sarah. I miss Pop-Up. I think about the holidays. He's not going to be there. Christmas, Thanksgiving, Easter, 4th of July, your birthday. He was always there. Thanks, Sarah. We do miss Pop-Up as a family. We've been thinking a lot about the ways in which we miss him, but also the ways Pop-Up is still here for us. I don't usually choose to speak in front of people like this. Public speaking has an uncomfortable way of reminding me of my limitations, but today I'm standing up here because I wanted to say something about my dad. I think Dad had a similar sense of his limits, and I respected his humility. He was a smart, curious person who wanted to share ideas but not profess, who had an implicit strength but was gentle. He once said to me that you know you're really good friends with someone when you can be silent with each other. You don't have to say anything. You can just relax and be. Just be. He was a contrast to my mother, who was chatty and quick with a joke. And at times, that was either easier than my dad's silence. But at other times, I found silence a relief. He could be chatty himself, but there was no knee-jerk need for it. I didn't have to prove anything with him. He was one of the few people I knew who I never doubted loved me. He offered simple, clear love, and that carried me through some difficult times. He didn't always understand my choices, but that didn't really matter. For all his seriousness, Dad had a great sense of humor. One of the things he taught me was to take your anger and string together the longest series of expletives and four-letter words you could find until you laughed. I was a little surprised the first time I heard this technique. But then I thought it was brilliant. I haven't shared this one with Ryan Sarah yet. But he knew laughter bridges all divides and brings things down to earth. It taught me how laughter can reestablish connection and remind us we're all human. Other things he taught me: the power of observation, of curiosity, of going slowly and subtly with determination and care, the joy of making things with your hands. I watched him as he demonstrated self-sufficiency and a consciousness of the burdens that we place on others, how he made connections and took a long view on life, not getting caught up in the small stuff. And that sometimes the most important thing you can do is care. My father was someone who cared. He took his profession seriously and approached it from a place grounded in scientific and professional practice. But I remember him occasionally joking about being a faith healer. He knew the limitations of his profession, the many human factors that influence an outcome, that medicine is an art. He knew the value of listening, how a kind and caring ear can heal. He listened to the stories of his patients, and he knew the weight of the faith they put in him. When he faced his own death in the hospital, with this full understanding of the many influences on those caring for him and the need to make quick decisions in the midst of uncertainty, he chose not to open the many doors of doubt that surrounded him. Instead, he picked his way across this minefield of doubts and disappointments and chose to keep faith in those caring for him. And with the same clarity and bravery, he faced his death. Some of his last words were, as I remember them, that life only gives you so many chances. You get another one, and then another one, and then it's time to go, he said. I've had a good life. And that's a credit to everyone here. I thank everyone for the part that you played in his life. And I know we're in good company. How many people have stood up here and cried about losing their loved ones? Love is what makes life beautiful and profound, and I'm so grateful for having known Dad's love and witnessed it, however imperfectly I love. So Dad taught me something about how to live, but also about how to die. Death looked him in the face, and Dad didn't turn away. So instead of Yoda from Star Wars, he taught me to hang out with 9-year-olds a lot. I'm going to quote Dumbledore from Harry Potter. Death is but the next great adventure for the well-organized mind. And I like to think of Dad as off on his next great adventure. And like I said, he's, in some way, he's still here. At the very least, the part of us that is him, that bears his imprint, is still here. And we can't lose that. So I'm going to leave you with an image. One of the last stories my dad shared was about visiting the art museum in St. Louis. Soon after, they had their first kid, Catherine. Overhead hung a giant Caldermobile, the kind that looks like a cross between the spine of a giant whale and sails. Dad and Mom would stand under it and blow. The guards didn't like this, but Mom and Dad couldn't resist, and they knew Calder was the kind of artist that would want them to have fun with his work. It was a mobile, after all. And I like thinking about their breath, the joy and laughter and simplicity of it. Just simple breath moving something so big.
I'm Dick's nephew from Detroit. Dick Loyer, Uncle Dick, as he was to me, lived a full, complete, and really correct life. He was a man who did things right and was a tremendous role model for me. He had so many things in his life that gave it meaning and touched on some of them, as did Peter. Really started with his family, though. His great love and partnership and unrelenting support for his wife, my Aunt Mary, Carol. His daughter's Catherine Ann, sons-in-law, who he took on as sons, really. He was so proud and happy of them. And of course, the top of the heap, really, Ryan and Sarah, whom he was so proud and so excited and had so much fun with. He was so kind and generous, too, to Mary's sisters, my Aunt Babs and my mom, Ruth, and to my brother and me. He really supported us tremendously. He was a man of faith and loved the church, loved being here, singing with the choir, loved sailing, woodworking, traveling the world with Mary, gardening, the horses, supporting Catherine Ann's horseback riding adventures over the years. He's a proud member of the 1st Litchfield Artillery Regiment, who are represented out in front. He loved being outside, loved walking in the local woods, volunteered at the food pantry and locally. He had a great love of sports and kept his rooting interest in the University of Michigan and Detroit sports teams that he grew up with, even though he moved here. And I think that says something good. I've never trusted somebody who relocated and then stopped rooting for their original team. But he kept it real with Michigan and Detroit. Although he did love Quinnipiac hockey as much as he loved the Michigan college hockey team. As Peter mentioned, he was an avid skier for many years. He spent a week or two at the Carlos Otis Clinic, working at the base clinic, treating skiers and other people who were injured on the hill or in the lodge. He loved hanging out with the ski patrol and hearing their stories. He was an avid member of NEMA, the Northeast Medical Association. He and Mary went annually on their ski trips east-west or to Europe, and they were very generous in inviting my brother and me along to many of these, which is how we got in a lot of skiing as we were growing up. He was an excellent physician, an orthopedic surgeon. He really loved his patients, as Ann said, and he loved the calling and the craft of surgery. He talked to me a lot about that. And this area is really important to me. I'm a physician, and I became interested in medicine. I really looked at him as a role model. As a teenager, he very kindly let me come with him to the hospital and to round with him. He took me to the operating room to watch him operate. I remember the first operation, he put me up on a 3-foot perch and then made an incision in the knee. I almost fell off the perch and passed out. Watching, but I recovered, and they took me to inpatient units, and I remember showed me 4 young men who had been injured in motorcycle accidents and told me I might want to think twice if I ever thought of riding a motorcycle. I never did after that. He introduced me to his colleagues, he answered questions, he never really pushed me toward medicine, but was very happy for me when I chose that career, and was very encouraging to me along the way. So Uncle Dick was cool, he was fun. As a teenager, he took me to see Easy Rider and MASH, 2 R-rated movies, which was pretty great back in the early 70s. He had stereo headphones, which were really cool too. He's a really smart guy who lived and just loved to learn about everything, from world history to local geology to meteorology, the arts, music, painting, and people in general. He's really a student of life. He had a Renaissance man's approach to the world, I think, and a great sense of humor about himself and the world. I love the story Ann told about the string of expletives. That's a great example. And he's a strong person, both physically and in his character. Growing up, it seemed to me like he was a permanent fixture, that he would be there forever, like some mighty oak or maple towering over a field. And that made me think about a poem that I'll share with you, written by Maya Angelou, called When Great Trees Fall. When great trees fall, rocks on distant hills shudder. Lions hunker down in tall grasses, and even elephants lumber after safety. When great trees fall and forest, small things recoil into silence, their senses eroded beyond fear. Great souls die, the air around us becomes light, rare, sterile. We breathe briefly, Our eyes briefly see with a hurtful clarity. Her memory suddenly sharpened, examines, gnaws on kind words unsaid, promised walks never taken. Great souls die, and our reality bound to them takes leave of us. Our souls, dependent on their nurture, now shrink, wizened. Our minds, formed and informed by their radiance, fall away. We are not so much maddened as reduced to the unalterable ignorance of dark, cold caves. And when great souls die, after a period, peace blooms, slowly and always irregularly. Space is filled with a kind of soothing electric vibration. Our senses, restored, never to be the same, whisper to us, they existed, we can be and be better for the existing. So while we mourn his death and we'll all miss him dearly, he did live a full, purposeful, wonderful life.